This afternoon, we have with us Meghna Nasre from IIT Madras. She is an assistant professor in the Department of Computer Science and Engineering at IIT Madras. She did her UG at NIT Nagpur and her PG degree in IIT Bombay. And she received her PhD in graph algorithms from IISc Bangalore. Her area of interest includes graph algorithms, matchings in graphs with preferences. She has also worked in Cisco and Yahoo 1 year at each place. So we are very glad that you are here this afternoon. And she has already done a couple of talks with us. There is in an earlier FDP, she has talked about this. We received great feedback from all the audience. So please make use of the session. Yeah, thank you.
I really thank the organizers for giving this opportunity to me. I have had, as she said, I have had this opportunity earlier, and it's my pleasure to be here again at SSM. Okay, so the title of the talk is Bipartite Matchings and the Stable Marriage Problem. So to get a sense of what all is known about this, can we have some show of hands or something that have we already seen this earlier or you have taught this? Okay, so is the term matchings familiar? Matchings is familiar, okay. And so prior to this, in this FDP itself, you have looked at some exposure to graphs and algorithms, the techniques to analyze algorithms, and some paradigms in algorithmic design, that is greedy, then divide and conquer and so on, right? So we are going to look at a specific problem and we are going to possibly apply some of the techniques that we have learned and learn a few new techniques. So before we go into the actual problem, I thought it's an afternoon session, so maybe we should start with something which actually is not very intimidating. So I'm sure everybody has seen this chessboard. We either, even if we don't play chess, we are familiar with the chessboard. It's a simple 8x8 chessboard. And before we go to the question on the slide, let us ask ourselves. So suppose I give you this chessboard and I give you these tiles of this form. So I give you tiles which are of this 2x1. That is, they occupy two cells on this chessboard. And let's say that we have a chessboard which is intact, not with something removed or something. But then is it possible to tile the chessboard? Tile in the sense cover the chessboard using these tiles which are also known as dominoes. Is it possible to cover the chessboard completely? When I say cover the chessboard, the whole chessboard should be covered by these tiles and there should be no tile which is hanging outside, is the question. So can we tile this chessboard if you are given a complete 8x8 chessboard? Yeah, there are several ways to tile the chessboard, right? Now let's say I remove one corner. You see the yellow piece coming outside, right? Let's say that you remove just one corner and the problem is again the same. Can you tile the chessboard using dominoes? Okay, and what is the reasoning behind this? Yeah, one cell. Right, but why, so what, yeah, it's correct, you cannot tile it, but there should be a slightly more formal reasoning. No, but I have not even removed both the tiles. I have just removed one tile, and it's very clear that you cannot tile it, right? So and everybody sees the obvious thing, but the reason is that you are left with how many squares now? We are 63 squares when we have just one of the tiles removed. On the other hand, once you have to cover with these dominoes, you are going to only cover even number of squares. And therefore, you are going to say that, yeah, if you give me just 63 squares in this, I'm not going to be able to tile it. And now we come to the problem on this slide, that is, which we are asking that, okay, we are removing two corners of this, and is it possible to tile it? So I hope the question is clear. Now we come to this chessboard, where two corners of the chessboard are removed, two cells of the chessboard are removed, and we want to still tile the chessboard with a domino. Is it possible? What is the intuition? So nobody asks you to put dominoes only horizontally. You can put them vertically, horizontally. There are several ways, right? Yeah, so what is the intuition? Can you tile it or can you not tile it? We can tile it, right? Okay. So is the general consensus that we can tile it? We cannot. Okay. So the correct answer is we cannot, but we are going to actually look at why we cannot. And once you know it is cannot, we are going to possibly come up with some arguments, but we need to give a formal proof that it, no matter how you keep these tiles, how you are allowed to keep the tiles in any ways, I mean, you are allowed to keep them horizontally like this, some of them vertically and so on. And that is why our first answer seems to be that, okay, maybe there is a way I can arrange them. And there are certainly now even number of squares. So the even odd argument, the parity argument no longer continues because there are 62 squares and dominoes can cover even number of squares. But doesn't mean that every kind of pattern can be covered. So we'll come to this towards in the middle of the talk. But now let's get back to some business. So I'm sure all of us as faculty members have to do several other routine tasks in the department other than the favorite task, which is teaching. So we do things like, okay, we are in committees like allotting, a project allotment committee. We have course allotment committees. So do these things happen in your institutes? And how do you do these allotments? So I'm sure there are BTEC projects, which BTEC project students are there. So how are these allotments typically done? Or what is the procedure that is followed? Yeah, so priority is given by whom? Okay. So let's say that you are offering some project and lot of students want to come to your project. Then do you also get a priority to select? So it is conceivable, right, that if you are offering a project which is in very high demand, then you would want to take the good students, right? And therefore there are these two-way preferences, right? You are thinking of students have some way to order projects. There are faculty members who think that this student is very suitable for this project and I would like to choose these students, right? So for a particular project, there's a different ordering of students. For another project, a different ordering may be possible because not all the projects require the same skill sets, right? So we routinely do this, routinely encounter this problem. But how do you do this allocation finally? Somebody, some small set of people sit down and then they do this allocation, right? Because we have some 15 to 20 faculty members and 60 students, we manage to do this, or we have some 30 groups, maybe if projects are done in pairs, then you have 30 groups. So you actually do this manually, right? So again, this is one problem that we'll look at, but let's look at this, the same problem at a larger scale. So how many of you have heard this term JOSA or the joint seat allocation? Okay, so so I'll tell you some history behind this. So JOSA has been introduced only last year in India. So we, prior to this, we had the IITs, which all these Indian Institute of Technology, going their own way for their examinations. That is, we had the JEE mains and JEE advanced, and we rank students according to that. Then whoever clears, we'll ask them preferences, which seat do they want to go to. And then they actually go to, they get according to their ranks in JEE. But then what this had a peculiar problem that suppose somebody gets a low ranked seat at IIT, he actually takes that seat at IIT, say some mining course in IIT, at some IIT, somebody takes that course, but eventually in an NIT he gets a computer science seat, then he actually leaves this seat. But once we are done with our allocation, that seat of mining, he or she has paid the fees. We think that seat is taken. So eventually you had these leftover vacant seats. And the correct way, or one of the correct ways to do this, is to get pool together these NITs and IITs and do a joint seat allocation. That is, all these NITs, IITs, DFTs, the government funded institutes, get together. They have to say that, okay, we are going to open our seats together. And a student now is not only giving his preferences only over the IIT courses or the NIT, but a interleaved sequence. So for example, so the participants in this JOSA or the joint seat allocation are the students who have passed 12th standard, and the other side is programs at various institutions. So maybe a CSE IIT Bombay program is one entity which has some 35 seats and so on. Of course, there are a lot of complications when you come to real life. There are quotas, there are other things and so on. But we'll simplify, keep things simple for the moment. So when a student, let's call him Rohan, he wants to give his preferences. What does he say? Maybe he says that CSE IIT Bombay is his most preferred course. If he doesn't get that, then maybe he wants to go to NIT Suratkal, NITK, and take a CSE program there. If he doesn't even get that, he wants to go to a new IIT, say NIT Palakkad or something, and go to a CSE program. And the list may be long, but this is a representative list. But the other side, that is the programs or the problem or the difficulty stems in from the fact that there are these one set of institutions, the IITs, let's call them the IITs, they are actually ranking students according to one method, that is the JEE Advanced. They of course hold JEE Mains, that is the main first level entrance exam, but that is only used as a screening purpose. The actual allocation is going to happen based on this JEE Advanced. On the other hand, let's look at an NIT, that they are not going to rank, they are not even going to consider JEE Advanced. They only look at JEE Mains and ask, how are you ranked according to JEE Mains? So now, a student, let's look at these two cases. Some student who is ranked higher, so of course rank 10 is better than rank 32. So Avanti is ranked better in JEE Mains, and so she should come before this Rohan in this ordering. But on the other hand, if you look at JEE Advanced, the ordering is flipped. So there is no one single ordering according to which you can rank these students and say that, okay, come in this order, whatever is available, we'll give it to you. This was the thing that was being done earlier for NITs and IITs. So now you see a problem that you cannot come up with a single ranking, and nobody will agree that, okay, I'll do your rank half of this plus half of this. Nobody is going to agree. They actually are very passionate about their own tests. So they will say that, no, we are going to only rank according to JEE Advanced. So how do you actually solve such a problem where you have multiple lists and you cannot come up with a single list of one side, let's say the student, and you still want to do allocation? And now the scale of the problem is huge. I mean, you have some 34,000 seats across the country and you have 1.5 lakh students. Nobody can sit down and do this manual allocation to ensure that some kind of optimality is met, or no unfair things happen and so on. And all this is subject to the fact that people are pouncing on us if there is any mistake that happens into this allocation. So we need robust algorithms. We need algorithms, or we need programs which are going to be very, 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 very efficient. You have this large scale of the problem. You cannot have something which goes on for days. As soon as the results are declared, you want to do this in some finite amount of time, and you want to do it correctly. So these two things, that is, correctness, what you want to guarantee. So nobody tells you that everybody has to get the first choice seat. That is not fair, or that is not realistic. But whatever your optimality is guaranteed, that should be met, is what we want. So we want to say that given a problem, we want to ask, what is it that we want to meet? What is the allocation, goodness of the allocation that we want to meet? Once we agree to that, both the parties involved, we are going to strive to design an algorithm which meets that. And we cannot say that, okay, on some instances it meets it, some instances it doesn't meet it. We want to make sure that on all instances that can come up in the in practice, we want to ensure that that optimality criteria is met, right? So this is just a flavor of problems that can come up in real life. And actually these look very disparate, right? I mean, they do not seem to have any connection. But in fact, a very nice theory of matchings and the stable marriage algorithm is going to tie them in today's talk. Hopefully, at the end of these 3 hours, it will be clear why all these problems were talked about in the beginning of the talk. Right? So, any questions about the problems that we spoke about just now, or any comments? So, I hope all of you understand the problem. We can go ahead and now try to design or see what we want to do to solve it. Okay. So now we'll go to our blackboard kind of style where we are going to do some theory material and then go back to these problems and ask, have we actually solved any of them? Right. So we'll quickly have a brief introduction to a graph. Then we will look at matchings in graph. And so the title says bipartite matching and the stable matching. But what I will do in my presentation is I'm going to talk about matchings in general, because a lot of theory that is applicable to bipartite matchings follows straightforward to general graphs. Bipartite graphs are only a subclass of graphs that can arise in practice. And therefore, we'll learn the theory for general graphs. And exactly when it requires to deviate to bipartite graphs, we are going to introduce bipartite graphs and say that why these things don't work for general graphs. And then we'll talk about the stable marriage problem. Yeah, please feel free to interrupt, ask questions. Let it not be a one-way interaction. Okay, good. So, what problems have you looked at where graphs were useful? So, were graphs done in the earlier sessions, or did you use graphs? Okay. To find distance between shortest part distances. Yes, good. Anything else? Somebody said something. Prim's algorithm. Okay. Yeah. So the spanning tree problem, right? Okay. So, but before we go to the algorithms, we want to ask, when are graphs useful? So whenever we have objects, discrete objects like cities, and we want to have binary relationships between them, we want to say that the distance between this city and this city is X, this city and this city is Y, and so on. We can very well use graphs to represent such binary relations. So whenever we have relations like we have friend network, we have this co-authorship network when you have research papers. Several places, there are some entities. For example, the people are the set of vertices. The edges are there whenever there is a friendship relation, whenever there is a co-authorship relation between the two parties involved. So this is a graph which you must have encountered, or these graphs are very common that you have drawn. And this is a very small example of a graph. So you have a graph with six vertices and some relationship shown between them. I think there are eight edges. Yeah, so E is equal to 8. So we'll conveniently use this notation, that is the graph GVE, N is the number of vertices, and M is the number of edges. So N, I hope this notation is familiar to you by now. Okay, so whenever I'm given a graph with N vertices, what is the largest number of edges that I can have? N. 10. In this graph, 10, is it? Okay, how did you compute this 10? Okay, so let's try to make sure that we have a graph with 10 vertices. So maybe you want to add these edges V4, V5, V2, V5. That is why you are saying 10, right? But good. So you can certainly have 10 edges. But is this the largest possible? Can you add some more edges? Yes. So what is the largest possible? You can answer in this graph. Also, you can answer in general when N is the number of vertices. 2 into number of vertices, right? This is what people feel. Okay, so here how many would that be? 12. So what is the logic behind 2 into N? Okay, N factorial ways is it N factorial ways? Okay. So yeah, good. This is a good observation. Okay. N into N minus 1 by 2, how did it come up? It's the correct answer. Yeah, NC2, but how is it coming up? Good. So we have now converged on the correct answer. These are lower bounds. I mean these are certainly the number of edges can be larger than this. But so one of the easy ways to look at it is there is one vertex, let's call it V. There are other n minus 1 vertices here. You can have edges to possibly all of them, right? And therefore, you will have n minus 1 edges coming up from this vertex. But then there are n minus 1 edges coming from all the vertices. But then I should say n into n minus 1. But then why did I say n into n minus 1 by 2 is the correct answer? With this, I am counting the same edge twice from both the endpoints, from the V and the U endpoint. And therefore, you have to divide it by 2. So you can have n into n minus 1 by 2. That is, m is less than or equal to n into n minus 1 by 2, which is order n squared is what we know, right? So we can have about n squared edges in the graph, order n squared edges in the graph. Good. And I'm sure you have seen this adjacency list, adjacency matrix representations of the graph. So you have an adjacency list where you will say that every vertex is actually having a list associated with itself, which looks like this. So this is V. What do I store in this list? Yeah. Are you familiar with this adjacency list representation? Okay, so what do I store in this? Adjacent vertices. So the neighbors of the vertex are stored in this, right? So if here it was V1, then I would store V2, V6, V3 and so on in the adjacency list. In an adjacency matrix, you will have what? Vertices on both the sides. So it is an n squared size matrix, n into n. And what does the ijth entry tell us? 0 or 1 depending on whether the edge is present or not. So are these, why do we have these two different representations? Okay. Good. So now even if you have this sparse graph where you have fewer than, so in this you will actually be able to say that there are how many edges now that we have the formula n into n minus 1 by 2? 15, right? So we are able to have 15 edges, but let's say we have this sparse or slightly smaller graph where we have just 8 edges, then we can actually store in something where we require only n plus m space. And remember this order, as you must have seen, hides some constant. So you will be able to store it in order m plus n space, where you will not be required to have an n into n sized matrix if you use the adjacency list representation. On the other hand, the adjacency matrix representation will, irrespective of whatever is the number of edges, you will always allocate yourself an n squared matrix and have zeros or ones whether for whenever an edge is present or not. Good. And so is there some simple question that you can answer well with adjacency matrix, and you may take some time to answer it with adjacency list? Whether there is an edge between two vertices, you can quickly answer how long does it take in an adjacency constant time, and how long does it take in the adjacency list representation? Okay, so can you be precise? What is this? How long does it take? Big O of n? Yes. But if you know that there is a bound on the degree of the vertices, then you can say that it takes order delta, where delta is the maximum degree of the graph. So these are basic things, but once we are all clear about this, then we can move ahead. And we are also familiar with these very simple techniques, which is a breadth first search, depth first search. The breadth first search explores the graph in a breadth first manner, and it also, you can think about it as starting at some vertex. If you start at V2, it is going to look at all the neighbors of V2 before it moves on to Earth. So it gives a level wise exploration of this graph. On the other hand, a depth first traversal is going to look at it depth first and find the deepest path and then move on. So all these things are familiar. Both these search techniques are very routinely used, and they take only linear time in the size of the graph. So they actually take time which is order m plus n. why I say m plus n is linear, because you actually need to store the graph and look at the graph if you wanted to explore the graph completely. So you require time which is different. Okay, so now we'll move on to actually today's topic, where we are going to talk about matching. So before I even go to matching, since some of you said that you have heard about matching, what are matching? What is a matching in a graph? Okay, good. So it's correct that you are trying to find a pairing, but now in terms of vertices and edges, we are only going to talk about graphs, vertices, edges. So can you talk about matchings as a subset of some quantity that you have looked at? So when you are correct, you said that you take a vertex, you match it to at most one vertex. Some vertices are going to be matched, some vertices are going to be left free, and in fact, you can think about, so this is our old graph where the red edges form a matching. So we are more formally going to say that the set of edges M forms a matching. So matching a set M forms a matching if it is a subset of the set of edges. Remember, E is the set of edges of the original graph, which gives all the relationships between the objects that we are interested in, and we are looking at a subset of the edge set, such that no two vertices share an endpoint. So as soon as I look at only the red edges, however the red edges may be placed, if you call the red edges as a set of matching edges, then you'll be sure that every vertex appears at most once in this set. It can have at most one edge, it can have no edges incident, just like V5 has no edges incident on it. You may have some vertices which have no matched partner, but every vertex will have at most one. So can you think of reasons why you want to come up with matching? Reduce computation time. Yes. Computation time of what?
You want to make shortest path from source to destination.
Okay.
What is the magnitude of match?
Okay, but these edges do not have weight, at least as of now, right? So, yes, you can try to do that, but unless you have relationship between the weights and the match pairs, and
there may not be any relationship, right? It's a good attempt, but I don't see how we can go forward to reduce computation time of shortest path. But yes, there are applications of weighted matchings at other places, but I will not come to that. But very naturally, where do matchings come up? So let's say you have, yes?
One-to-one involvement, like one job
assigned
to one person. Okay, good. So maximum number. Good. So there is where you have jobs, machines, you want to assign jobs
to machines. But more generally, you can think of the very regular problem where you have hostel rooms to be assigned into pairs, right? And suppose this tells you all the students are there. There are 6 students. They tell me V1, V2 would like to stay together, but V1 and V5 are enemies. They will not actually want to stay together, so they actually fight too much, so they are not going to ever stay together. So I cannot match V1 and V5, but I can indeed match V1, V2, V6, V3 and so on. But there are other ways to find matchings also, right? So whenever, let's say, a room can occupy only 2 people and you want to come up with an allocation which maximizes the number of people which are put into room or minimizes the number of rooms which are utilized, you are indeed going to find a matching in the appropriate graph. Okay. And as you have already said that you want to maximize the number of edges which are present, the red edges that are present, you would like to get as large as a possible matching that you can get. So this is what it says. So now, is this the largest possible matching that you could have come up with in this graph? No, okay. Yeah, so I would like more participation. So if things are not clear, this is a good time because we haven't moved too much ahead. We still can go back and correct some things which were not clear. Yeah, so can you, yes. Is this the largest possible thing? So are you clear with what is a matching? Okay. So what I want to ask you is, okay, is there an alternate matching? Let's ask a different, easier question. Is there another way to pair up people? Okay, good. So what is another way to pair up people? Yeah, so maybe somebody wants to answer, yeah. V3, V4, V5, V6, V1, V2. Okay, good. So let's check whether this is a matching. V3, V4, V5, V6 and V1, V2. Good. So in fact, you people have come up with a matching which is of size which is larger than what is given on the slide and which also retains one of the edge V1, V2. Right? So now, good. So this is a valid matching. You have come up with something which is larger. So clearly, this is not the largest size matching that is possible. But there is something good about this, or there is something which you can say which is non-trivial. So now I would ask you the following question. Good, you have come up with a matching or a pairing which is of size 3. I showed you a matching which is of size 2. Can you come up with a matching which is of size 3, but which does not throw out any edge that is given here? So you are not allowed to throw away any red edge. You can add more edges. Of course, you cannot change the binary relation, the graph that is given to you, but you cannot throw away. So you did very nicely. You actually V3, V4, V6, V5, you paired at the expense of dropping V3, V6, right? But if I forbid you from doing that, and there is no reason to forbid as of now, but yeah, if somebody forbids you, can you actually get a matching in this graph? You can try and answer, yeah. As soon as you try to match anybody, you are either going to hit, you are hitting one end which is a matched end. So let's take any non-red edge or a gray edge and try to match it. So let's say V3, V4. As soon as you try to match it, you see that one of its endpoint is matched. If you try to do it with V1, V6, you see that one of the endpoints is matched. So, or both the endpoints are matched, right? So you see that although you haven't computed something which is as large as possible, you have computed something which cannot be expanded, right? And there is this term which is called as maximal. So this matching is as large as you can get with this set of edges. It is not the maximum possible, but it is a set of edges, M, such that, so M is maximal if, there exist no M prime such that M prime is a superset of M. So it should actually be a strict superset of M. So that is, you are not able to actually increase the size of the matching without giving away something else. So let me ask you this question. Now if I had the set of edges forming the matching, let me call the matching M1. As just the V1, V2, right? This is the only edge in my matching. Is this a valid matching, first of all? Yes. Is it a maximal matching? No. Because, in fact, you have this V1, V2, V3, V6, which is size larger without giving away anything. Similarly, you had the larger matching, this one, which is also greater than this and which is a strict superset of this. So certainly such matchings are not maximal matchings. But let's ask, if somebody asks you to find a maximal matching, you are just interested in computing a maximal matching now. You clearly know that this is not good enough. You can get a matching of size 3. So we are interested in computing maximum matchings. But let me ask, if one asks you to create a maximal matching, what would be your approach? So when do you say that a greedy approach, right? So now she's applying today morning's technique, very good. So we are now utilizing our knowledge that we have obtained in the first class for the second class, which is very good. So we will take, so the approach is the following. You want to take every edge. So let's say that you have ordered the edges in no particular order. You take one edge, you say that your current set of matching edges is empty. So you maintain this, start with this empty set phi, and then keep on adding edges to this M as long as what happens? Yeah, as long as you can keep adding. That is, you are always maintaining a set of edges which form a matching. That is, whenever I add V1, V2, then if my next edge happens to be V5, V6, yes, I can add it. But if my the next edge happens to be V2, V6, I will not be able to add it because I have already added V1, V2. Right? So this approach clearly gives you a matching. Why is it maximal? So now you have to prove the correctness. That is, yeah, whatever I did, I will get a matching in the end. It may be a smaller size matching than the largest possible, but I indeed get a matching which is maximal, to which I cannot add a new edge. And this is very obvious, right? For the sake of contradiction, there exists a matching, so your algorithm produces this M. Suppose an adversary tells you that there is an M prime, which is a strict superset of this, then you must ask, there must be an edge which belongs to M prime, but which does not belong to M. When this edge was being considered, I considered all the edges in my sequence, and this edge was being considered, what happened? It must be the case that I threw it away because there was one edge incident on one of its endpoints which was already present in M, and therefore my algorithm never removes anything from the given current set of edges that I have picked. Therefore that edge must have continued. Therefore either this is not a matching, or this contradicts that this is a super strict superset. I am not claiming that we have computed the largest size, but this simple greedy strategy will certainly give you something which is a maximal matching, right? And what is the running time, or how long do you take to do this algorithm? This greedy algorithm, which is very simple. So remember, we have m edges, little m edges, and little n vertices. So you certainly have to look at every edge, and you can assume a suitable representation to ask that this question, that given two vertices, given an edge, is one of its endpoints or both of its endpoints are marked. That is, are they matched or are both of them free, can be answered in constant time by keeping just one marker with every vertex. And therefore, you will have an algorithm which runs in order m time. So this is a simple greedy algorithm which we have seen, which will give us an order m time algorithm to compute a maximal matching, need not be the maximum size matching, right? And you have already given me a larger size matching in this graph, which this is the one which you told, which is going to be which is in this case size 3. And our goal is indeed to compute a matching which is of as large size as possible. That is, in this case, the 3 size matching. And what this says is that a maximum matching is always going to be larger than or equal to any maximal matching. In fact, every maximum cardinality matching is also a maximal matching, but it is a special kind of maximal matching. Okay, good. So at this point, let's ask, what are ideas to actually get to maximum cardinality matching? So now we are not into the area where we are not allowed to delete edges. Delete edges that we had already put in. So we may have started with a set. We are allowed to correct this set, possibly by throwing away something. Maybe you made a mistake. For example, just like I made a mistake by choosing this V3, V6. I give ourselves the opportunity to correct our mistakes, but we should correct them so that eventually we halt or eventually we converge to something which is meaningful. Yeah, so actually at this point, yeah, we can do some brute force trial and error, but yeah, and I'm sure this came up via several trials and something, but so this, the ideas that are developed now or which will be which will be which we'll be looking at now, are coming from the flow theory. So I'm sure you have looked at maximum flows yesterday, and you have looked at networks where you had directed networks, you had edge capacities, and you wanted to push as large as possible flows. And you must have looked at something like the augmenting path, that is, given some initial flow, you want to say that maybe I want to correct the flow, maybe I sent a wrong flow along something, maybe I want to send some flow back and correct it so that I get as large flow from S to T. And these ideas of augmentation actually apply to this, or and the name itself, the augmenting path, is also coming from. So we are going to look at some special kinds of paths now. We'll first look at some paths which are called as alternating paths. So remember, we started off with some matching. We don't know whether it is a largest size matching. It could be smaller than the largest size. It could be the largest size. But we have started with some matching. So at this point, let me ask you. So suppose I tell you this set M, which is the set which does not contain any edge. M is equal to phi. Is this a matching? Does this set qualify to be a matching? Trivially. So at this point, if it doesn't occur to you that this is a matching, we should go back to the definition. It is a subset of edges. A set of edges is called a matching if it is a subset of the edge set such that no two edges share an endpoint. So now, if you see this, it is phi certainly a subset of the edge set, and since there are no edges, you don't even have to look at any two edges and ask, do they share an endpoint? It is trivially a matching. So yes, if you start with the empty set, your algorithm is invariant. The invariant that it is maintaining a valid matching in the original graph throughout the execution. Good. So an empty set is also a matching. So let me start with any matching, and to make it concrete, maybe there are some edges in the matching, just like we have these red edges. So we are going to define some paths which are called as alternating paths. So by the name of it itself, it says that it is going to alternate between something. It is going to alternate between matched edges and unmatched edges, right? So the gray edges are the unmatched edges, the red edges are the matched edges. And a sample alternating path is shown here, that is V5, V6, it is an unmatched edge. Then there is a V6, V3, and there is a V3, V4. So it should be a simple path in the graph. This is very important. It should be a simple path in the graph. That is, it doesn't take the same vertex again. And it should have this nature that it should take a matched edge, unmatched edge, matched edge. It can start anywhere. So just so that we are sure that we understand, can you name some other alternating paths in the graph? It just has to be alternating. You can start at any edge. The next edge you have to take has to be the other type of edge. The next edge that you have to take is the other type of edge, and it should never come back to the same vertex. So it should be a simple path. Yes? V2, V1, V3, V6, V5. So this is a valid alternating path. V2, V1, V3, V6, V5 is a valid alternating path. Any other path? So again, trivial path, for example, V4, V6 is also a valid alternating path because it just has one edge. So there's nothing to refute. It is a simple path. It has one matched edge. If there is another edge, it has to be one unmatched edge. If there is another edge, it has to be a matched edge. But there is no another edge, which is fine. Right? So these are trivial alternating paths, V4, V6, V3, V4, and so on. We are not going to be interested in these trivial ones. We are going to be interested in something more meaningful. Okay, so, and the important thing is there are paths which are not alternating. So, can somebody name paths which are not alternating? Or any path that you can come up here is alternating. No, I want to ask you, tell me a path which doesn't qualify as an alternating path. V1, V2, V6, V4. Okay, good. So this path V1, V2, V6, V4 is not an alternating path because it actually has two edges which are unmatched edges, right? So you cannot have such a path as an alternating path. Similarly, you cannot have a path which is like this. V1, V5, V6, V3, V1, V6, because it is taking the same vertex again. So these two things, I have missed writing the simple thing there, but it is very crucial that you should have a simple path which doesn't take the same vertex again, and it is also of this nature that it has one alternating edge, one matched edge, the other which is unmatched edge, right? So now looking at this alternating path, does it ring a bell? What can we do if we have alternating path defined and given to us? Can we do something which helps us improve the size of the matching? So was this term augmenting path used yesterday or right? Yeah. So you augment the flow by using some path, right? Similarly, we are going to augment the matching by using some path, is the idea here. Okay, so a very suggestive path is shown here, right? So the V5, V6, V3, V4 path is given to you. It is certainly an alternating path, but it is more than only an alternating path. It has a special characteristic that both its endpoints are unmatched, or also they are called as free vertices, right? So vertices which are matched will be called as matched vertices. Vertices which are free are called unmatched or not matched, therefore they are called free, right? So this path has a very peculiar characteristic, that is V5, V6, V3, V4 has both its endpoints to be free. We said that alternating paths need not have this characteristic, they can start anywhere, end anywhere, but there are these paths which are augmenting paths, so they are certainly alternating, therefore they have to be simple, they have to take matched edges, unmatched edges in this alternation, but in addition they should have this characteristic, that is there is a free, they both have the endpoints, the path has two endpoints and both of them should be left free, right? So now given this, that this is an augmenting path and these are also useful, now what can one do? And you also know what is the larger size matching, right? So you also know the three size matching in this graph. So I give you a simple path which has both its endpoints which are matched, which are free, and every other edge in this path is of this form, that is it is a matched edge followed by a free edge, matched edge followed by a free edge and so on. So what can you now do? If the picture is not clear, then it could be a long path. This is a free vertex. Therefore the first edge is free, that is it is not a matched edge. The second edge has to be a matched edge because it is an alternating path. Then it is again a free edge. Then it is a matched edge. Then it is a free edge. Then it is a matched edge. Can I stop here? Can I stop drawing my path here? Yes, if it is alternating, but if it is augmenting, I want the other endpoint to also be free, therefore it looks like this. So now, let us, before we even use it, study some useful properties of augmenting paths. So, can you say something which is very peculiar about augmenting paths? She did not let me stop here, but maybe I could have gone ahead. Can I stop here? No, again, I actually have to go ahead. So every time I draw one matchstick, you are forcing me to draw one more unmatched. So now can somebody say anything about the length of an augmenting path? Okay, so let's start with simple things. Is this an augmenting path? This is a free edge in the graph. Is this an augmenting path? Yes, because it is certainly by trivial nature of the path, it is having alternating edges. It is just having one edge. Then both its endpoints are free. It is a simple path. Therefore, it is an augmenting path. Good. So now, is this an augmenting path? No, because it doesn't have the other endpoint. But now, good, I have this as an augmenting path. Now, does it tell you something that what is the length of an augmenting path?
Good. So there are
k unmatched edges, good, very nice observation. So if there are k unmatched edges, then k matched edges, then there are k plus 1 unmatched edges, right? And therefore, what can you say about such a path? It has actually 2k plus 1 for any k, it has 2k plus 1 edges, and therefore it has to be an odd length path. So as soon as you have augmenting paths, they have to be odd length, because every matched edge is paired up with an unmatched edge, but there is one more unmatched edge because it is augmenting and it has both its endpoints free, right? Therefore, you will have something which is an odd length path. And now with this odd length path, you know that there are more unmatched edges in that path than the number of matched edges. So now what can you do? Right. So this gives us the very nice trick that it tells us that, okay, why did I take this path and let this path pay me only k? It can pay me k plus 1 edges, right? Or it can give me k plus 1 edges just by flipping. And why is this flipping allowed? Because you know that it is never going to interfere with anything else. The rest of the matching remains as it is, because you know that on this vertex, this is the only edge which is matched. Therefore, if you had matched instead this vertex with this endpoint, nobody else is going to create a problem for you in terms of it being a matching. And this is the very clever idea or very useful idea, which again comes from augmentations of flows. It's a very similar idea that you take something and you actually try to push in. Similarly here, you take this path which has more unmatched edges than the matched edges, flip along that. And this operation is called something which is the XOR. So if you have forgotten it from the discrete math, let me just remind you. So if you have a set, you have a some set A, you have some set B, they can have possibly some intersection. This is, we are now talking about set of edges, but this applies to any set, yes, any two sets A and B. So if you had sets A and B, you call the XOR of these sets as what? So recall, union is all of this, intersection is just this, the part which is inside. It could be empty, it could be non-empty. What is XOR? It is the exclusive OR. It says that something that is present in A but not present in B, and something which is present in B but not present in A. So in fact, it is this part, present in A but not present in B, and similarly present in B but not present in A. So this operation is the exclusive OR, and when you take this path and when you do exclusive OR, what are you doing actually? Removing the matched edges and adding in unmatched edges. So when we say you have a matching M and you have an augmenting path, so augmenting paths and alternating paths are always with respect to some matching. So you cannot talk about them in a graph. You have to talk about them in a graph with a matching. So remember, we had a graph. We said there was a matching M, and we said that if P is an augmenting path with respect to it, with respect to this matching, then you can actually do this nice operation, which is M XOR P. For people who find it slightly difficult to abstract this out, you can think about that simple path that I had drawn and flip edges which are matched to unmatched, unmatched to matched. Although you should go back and think about this XOR operation, because it gives it more formalism. So now we clearly see that if you give me a matching and somebody tells me that, okay, with respect to your matching, there is an augmenting path which starts. So as soon as I mean augmenting path, it has to start with a free vertex, end at a free vertex, and every other edge in between is alternating. Then what will you do? Yes, flip, right? So you'll flip to get a larger size matching. So as long as somebody gives you matchings, somebody gives you an augmenting path, you'll be happy to flip along it to get a larger size, and you'll get a matching which is just one size larger than what you had initially. Right? But now, when do you stop doing this? Good. So you are saying that as long as there are augmenting paths, so suppose there is a black box access to some algorithm which tells you, given this graph and a matching, it supplies you the answer. Is there an augmenting path? Suppose there is such a algorithm, or suppose there is such a black box access, you will probe it. Is there an augmenting path? Give it to me. And then I will flip the edges, right? But now, his claim is that, okay, as soon as the black box says that there is no augmenting path, then you stop. What do you mean? Yeah, you stop, but then what do you claim about the output? Good. So now you want to claim that if there is no augmenting path, then the size of the matching is maximum. So this is known as, in fact, the Burr's theorem. That is a if and only if condition. That is, if there is an augmenting path, then the size of the matching can be increased. This is what we all agree, right? So if you give me an augmenting path, I will just flip the edges along that path to give you a larger size matching. But now the Burr's theorem says the other thing also, that if there is no augmenting path with respect to that matching, then you actually have found a matching which is of size maximum possible. So how do you prove this, right? Again, we said that if we are intending to get a largest size matching and our algorithm is this, which of course assumes this access to a black box which answers this question, given a graph and a matching, is there an augmenting path? This itself we have to design an algorithm, but we will come to it. But if somebody has designed this, and I want to say that now this, with the assumption of this black box, this algorithm is correct, I want to prove the following statement, that if the matching is maximum, then there is no augmenting path with respect to it. So that is the other side of the Burr's theorem. That is, if there is no augmenting path with respect to the matching, then M is maximum. So what are ways to prove such things? So you must have looked at techniques of proving things during either in the discrete math course when we teach these courses, or during proving correctness of greedy strategy or divide and conquer, you have looked at something. So what are proof techniques? How do we prove it? We'll come to it. But what are proof techniques? Contradiction. Okay, great. So it very naturally applies here. So let's try to prove it by contradiction. So now let's say that for the sake of contradiction, our matching M does not admit any augmenting path, but still it doesn't happen to be maximum. So therefore, there has to exist a matching which is, let's call it M prime. And we know, so this symbol is for the size of the matching, that is the number of edges in this matching. It has to be the case that the size of M prime is strictly greater than M. This is what we know because we have assumed for the sake of contradiction. But now, how can we proceed from here? Good, there is a matching which is of larger size, but the only handle, and again, we have to remember this, the only handle that we have is our assumption. That is, there is no augmenting path with respect to this. So, this is our assumption. If we have anything to contradict, this is the phrase that we have to contradict, or this is the fact that we have to contradict, right? So using this M prime, I want to somehow show a nice augmenting path with respect to M. If you can show this, then you are done. So is the broad picture clear? We are trying to compute a maximum cardinality matching in a graph. Remember, again, nowhere we have said that the graphs are bipartite. We are talking about general graphs till now. We are saying that if you give me a matching and I give you a black box axis, given this matching, does it have an augmenting path with respect to it? I will answer yes or no, that black box will answer. As soon as it stops answering yes, you are going to say that, okay, I have found out a matching which is as large as possible. This is the correct algorithm. But now I want to prove its correctness, because maybe I did not do the correct thing and missed out one small portion. So just to convince myself, I want to prove it so that nobody can ever say that, okay, this actually did not produce a maximum size matching. Okay, so at this place, again, we are going to use the XOR trick. So remember, what are M and M prime? They are only subsets of edges of the original graph. So both are subsets of the same type, that is, they are both subsets of the edges. Now, can you look at this set, which is M XOR M prime, which is again a set of edges. Think of M being this, M prime being this. You know that M XOR M prime looks like this. So, of course you have to keep the vertices, so I will call this a new graph. S is equal to V mx or m prime. That is, the edges are only coming from mx or m prime. That is, they have to be either present in m and not present in m prime, or present in m prime but not present in m, right? So there are some common edges. So if a matching, so now let me use some color. And everybody agrees that this is one valid matching in the graph. And let me now say that this is another matching where this edge is also used. So I'm just saying this green edge is there, and possibly this edge is there, and let's say that this edge is there, right? So this is also, the green edges also form a valid matching, right? So now let us try to draw the x or mx or m prime. So this is the graph. We are asking what is mx or m prime looking like. So let me call these vertices A1, A2, A3, B1, B2, B3, B4. So I have to draw another graph which is on the same vertex set, and I want you to tell me which edges should I draw. I have to draw only edges which are coming from mx or m prime. So let's ask this edge, a1, b1. Can I draw it in my graph, the edge graph? No, because it is coming from both mx, so it is lying in this intersection, so it cannot be drawn. Let us ask a1, b2. Can I draw that edge? Okay, so from where is it coming? So is it coming from m1? Sorry, is it coming from m? No. Is it coming from m prime? No. It is not even present in m and m prime, so it cannot be drawn. Right? So you have to draw only edges which are present in m but not present in m prime, and edges which are present in m prime but not. So a1, b2 edge also cannot be drawn. Let's ask a2, b2. Yes, and it is drawn because it comes from m, but it doesn't come from m prime. So it lies in this part. Similarly, I will draw this green edge, which is a2, b3. Then I will draw this edge and I will draw this edge, right? So these are the edges. So this edge is precisely coming from M, this edge is coming from M, and these are coming from M prime, the green edges, right? Although I have drawn all of them in green. So is this clear what we are drawing? We are taking every edge asking, are you present in MX or M prime? So you have to be either present in M or present in M prime but not present in both. So these are the edges coming, right? So now, good, we have drawn this for a particular graph. But does this have this graph, if I take any two matchings, M and M prime, in a graph G, which need not be bipartite, I very conveniently drew a bipartite graph here, but which need not be bipartite, can we say something about the graph that is drawn? It is going to have a very simple structure. So let us take every vertex and ask what is the degree of a vertex, what degree can it have? In this graph H, so in the original graph it may have a large degree, right? It can have lot of adjacent vertices. In this graph, what is the degree that it can have? Maximum 2, right? So can it have 0 degree? Yes, right, because see, for example, a vertex A1 has 0 degree. So it can have 0 degree when maybe originally it had 0 degree, or it had large degree but one edge was present, which was matched, was present in both of them, or none of the edges on incident on it were matched, right? For example, if it was, there was some isolated vertex B5 here, it was not matched in both, it will have a 0 degree, right? So there can be vertices of 0 degree. There can be vertices of degree 1, which are like B2. What does it mean if it has degree 1? If it has degree 1 in this graph, H, which is mx or m prime. Okay, so let us ask, why did you draw this edge a2, b2 in this graph? Because it came from either m or m prime, but not both. And therefore, head matching. But since this vertex has degree 1, it should be a free vertex in the other matching. Otherwise, the other edge would have come incident on it. Just like A2, since it is matched in both of them, it actually gets a degree 2. So all degree 2 vertices are vertices which are matched in both. All degree 1 vertices are vertices which are matched in exactly 1. And all degree 0 vertices are either left unmatched in both or are matched by the same edge in both. Right? This is a very nice graph, right? Which in which every vertex has degree 0, 1 or 2. And now, certainly it need not be a single connected component. The graph need not be a single connected component. But every connected component, what structure can it get? So you are familiar with simple graph structures like trees, paths, cycles, then, yeah. So what structures can you draw? Cliques and so on, right? Okay, so let me try to draw something and then maybe you'll say that, no, you should not draw this. So maybe I'll say that, okay, the graph looks like this. So can it look, B5, can it look like this? Okay, what is it refuting? At most 2, right? So therefore, I cannot draw such an edge, right? Anywhere I cannot draw a degree 3. But maybe I can extend this, right? This is a valid thing to do. So I can certainly extend that. But then how long can I keep extending? At some point, either I have to stop or I have to. So can I go back? Maybe I can go back, right, to one of them. So this need not be a bipartite graph, so I can actually go back anywhere. But in this, maybe can I go back to here? Something which is in between? No, because something which is in between was already having a degree 2. So therefore, I cannot go back to something which is in between. So I have to go back to something which was the first vertex of this path, which completes a simple cycle, right? So I can either have paths or I can have cycles, which are simple. So both, I can have both simple paths or simple cycles. So this mx or m prime is a very useful quantity, which tells us that if m and m prime are matchings in a graph, in the same graph, then this mx or m prime is a collection of, the graph mx or m prime is a collection of simple paths and cycles. But there is even more. So let's look at only cycles and ask, is there something about the length of this cycle that you can talk about? Again, only in terms of the parity. That is it even or odd? And again, the graph need not be bipartite. The graph can be a general graph which does admit odd cycles. But can, if you have a cycle, so now think about it. Why did you draw this edge? You drew this edge because it came from M. The other edge, immediate edge, has to be from the other matching, which is M prime, because you cannot have two consecutive edges coming from the same matching. Next edge has to be exactly coming from M, the other from M prime, and go on. So what can you say about the size of the cycle? Just like you did for the augmenting path, that is, there is exactly one unmatched edge more than the number of matched edges. You can now say that there are exactly equal number of M and M prime edges, because you must be having exactly M number of edges and M prime number of edges to make sure that it is a cycle. And therefore, this cycle has to be of even length. So all cycles are in this MX or M prime, which is this graph, are going to be even length cycles. And the paths need not be, paths can be of any type. There can be odd length paths, even length paths, and so on. Right? So much for just proving this theorem. But this is very good, this is going to be very useful. So now remember, why are we doing all this? Because we have an algorithm in mind which says that, okay, take a matching, give it to the black box, ask it, does it have augmenting paths? If yes, flip along that. If no, stop. And this stop has to be justified, is what we are doing. So we are saying that suppose for the sake of contradiction, there is a matching M prime which is larger in size. Then we looked at this quantity, which is H, the graph H, and we also argued lot of things. That is, we said that all the, it is a collection of paths and cycles, and these paths and cycles have some nice properties as well. Okay, now we still ask, what does it give us? we still want to complete the proof, and the only handle that we have is that these paths and cycles, or we started with a matching such that our black box answered that there is no augmenting path with respect to it, right? Yeah, so I would like, I think the proof is almost there, but we have to just finish off some, we have to dot the I's and cross the T's. So I need your help to do that. So we recall what we are trying to do. We have this matching M, which has been output by our algorithm. We want to show that it is the largest possible. We have said that suppose there is a matching M prime, which is not, which is larger than this, then we will also look at this XOR, and we will look at the graph that is formed by this XOR. It has to look like a collection of cycles and paths, right? And we want to, the only thing that we can refute or which we have as our handle is the absence of augmenting path. If using this, all this theory, you can show me an augmenting path, then we will say that, okay, but you promised me without matchings, without augmenting paths, then this is a contradiction. So where are these augmenting paths hidden is what we want to ask. Okay, so let's take every connected component of this MX or M prime and try to inspect it. So how does that connected component look like? We already said a lot of things about it. How does it look like? Yeah. So if people are lost, they should ask why, where they are lost or what they are not finding. Okay, so take one connected component. What can you see in that connected component? You know that it is either a path or a cycle, right? So let's say that it happens to be a cycle. Then what can you do? You certainly can apply the flip trick, but will it help us by flipping? Why will it not help us? There are equal number, right? So therefore, there is nothing to refute there, right? And you cannot show an augmenting path. Now let us look at a path. At least the path is a path what we wanted. So now, what can go wrong with a path? So can you say that if you take any path, it has to be an augmenting path? Recall that augmenting paths are with it has to be odd length, right? But how should it, why should it be odd of odd length? Maybe there, if you take a particular path, then it can so happen that it, so just like this path, right? This path that happened to be in this, with respect to M and M prime, it happened to be an even length path. So am I right? 1, 2, 3, 4, right? So it happened to be an even length path. So if you pick any arbitrary path, you cannot say that it is going to be an odd length path, right? But we want to show the existence of an odd length path. Very good. But then why should such an odd length path exist? Yeah, but why should it, yeah, it, if you flip, you will get the one, but why should such a path exist? Remember, we started with something, some M prime which has a cardinality which is strictly larger than M, right? So therefore, we know that there has to be, so if you take every path and it happens to be an even length path, then you are striking off an M edge with an M prime edge. Then this size cannot be larger, or it must be the case that there is one path in which you have more M prime edges than M edges. So I hope it is clear. You take a path, if it looks like this, throw it away. But then this is not adding anything to us. Therefore, you have counted exactly one M prime edge for an M edge. So, but you know that if this was, this your original size was 10, this was at least 11 or larger. Right? Because you said that I did not produce a maximum cardinality matching. There is some matching which is of larger size than whatever I produced. So there has to be, so if there cannot be a cycle which has more edges because we said cycles are of even length. Therefore, cycles don't give us anything. But there are paths. If all the paths were of even length, good. Then this itself is false. But if not, then there is at least one path. There may be more paths, but there is at least one path. And how does that path look like? It starts with some free edge with respect to M. then it takes an M edge, which is because we know that this structure H has, every vertex has degree at most 2 and edges are alternating. And now it goes on for a while, but again you know that it has to end in an edge which is, so yeah, it has to end in an edge which looks like this, right, which comes from M prime. If you did not have such a structure, you cannot have the case that M prime is strictly greater than M. Then where did you get the more edges from, right? So therefore, you must have this augmenting path, and such an augmenting path is what you were looking for. As soon as you show this augmenting path, you refute the claim that there was no augmenting path with respect to your given matching, and therefore you prove this, that if there is no augmenting path with respect to M, then indeed whatever you have produced is a maximum cardinality matching, right? So as much as it is integral that there are these nice ideas that we need to generate, we also need to formally prove that our ideas are correct. And for this, you require a little bit of mathematical notation, mathematical formalism that we need to, have practice in as well as imbibe in ourselves. So it is like a discipline. So yeah, that's all the proof that is there. So we look at this H, we show that every vertex has degree at most 2, and this forms a crucial aspect of proof at all places in matching theory, where you will be looking at this XOR operation and repeatedly using the fact that the graph formed using the XOR of 2 matching is a very simple graph which contains paths and cycles, where paths are of where cycles are of even length. And now the algorithm that we had in mind, which is also the iterative improvement algorithm, which one can very intuitively think of, is start with the empty matching, and as long as you can keep making an access to a black box which says, is there an augmenting path? If yes, give it to me. You are going to repeatedly keep asking the question and improve your matching, right? So there are these two questions that always need to be asked when you write an algorithm. Is it correct? And is its complexity, what is its complexity? If you have already achieved some complexity, can you improve it? Are the questions that we are going to ask always. So is correctness guaranteed to us now by our Birch theorem that gave us? And remember that we have never said that this framework doesn't work for general graphs. In fact, the same framework will work for general graphs as long as you can give me this black box. So we remember, everything is relying on this black box. Given a graph and a matching, tell me whether it has a augmenting path or not, and if yes, give me one, is the black box access which we have relied on. And we did not say how to address that. So now we are going to ask, how do we efficiently compute augmenting path in a graph, right? This is what is our question. So any questions still here? This is a place where we can stop and take questions or comments. Yes, so I think maybe, is it okay to schedule a break now and continue? Mm-hmm. Okay, so maybe we can stop here. We'll do the bipartite matching algorithm when we meet next, and we'll look at the running time complexity of that. Now the correctness is guaranteed. Once we have looked at that, I'll at least mention what are the improvements that are possible for the naive algorithm, and then we will move on to the stable matching.